Well, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for being here. So today we're going to talk about arthritis of the knee and the hip and treatment options for arthritis of the hip and knee. So this is a picture of my office. My practice is based out of Mount Dora. The practice is called Manoogian Guru for my partner, Dr. Manoogian, and myself. And we pretty much operate out of Florida Hospital Waterman. So let's talk about arthritis and the types and causes of arthritis. We'll talk about non-surgical treatment options as well as surgical treatment options. So arthritis. What is arthritis? I get this question a lot in the office. So we're going to talk about that. First, let's talk about the most common types of arthritis. The most common type of arthritis is osteoarthritis, which is a wear and tear type arthritis, where the cartilage of the joint wears out, and we develop a deformity. You can have the two bones rubbing together because the cartilage is worn out, causing severe pain. And that, like I mentioned, is the most common type of arthritis. Rheumatoid arthritis is an inflammatory condition where the body actually attacks the joints and causes pain and swelling. And as that progresses, you can develop the bone-on-bone arthritis, secondary to the cartilage wearing out from the inflammation. Post-traumatic arthritis is a result of an injury. For example, someone suffered a fracture into the knee joint or the hip joint or the pelvis from a car accident. And that in turn leads to arthritis in the future. Avascular necrosis is a condition where the blood supply to the joint is destroyed. Typically you see that in alcoholics or scuba divers. And also sometimes it happens for no reason, called idiopathic arthritis. So all of these conditions can be treated to relieve pain. And we're going to talk about that in the near future here. So let's look at a schematic of a normal knee. This right here is your femur bone, and this right here is your tibia, also known as the shin bone. And if you look at the white matter in between the two bones, that's the cartilage we're talking about. There's two forms of cartilage. There's hyaline cartilage, which is the cartilage on the bone, and then there's the meniscus, which is in between the two bones. This is a schematic of a arthritic knee, and you can see here, represented by this red material, that the cartilage has worn out. And once the cartilage wears out on both sides of the joint, you get the bone on bone, and you get the pain and the difficulty with walking, and you can also get a deformity. You can be knock-kneed or bow-legged as a result of the cartilage wearing out, whether it's on the inner side of the knee or the outer side of the knee. So this is an x-ray of a normal-looking knee, and you can see this space right here that's represented by good cartilage. Looking at the x-ray on the right, you can see that there's bone on bone on the inner side of the knee, showing that the cartilage is worn out. And you can also see that this patient has developed a deformity with the leg sort of bowing in, and that's as a result of the cartilage wearing out on that side. This right here is a hip joint. You're looking at the pelvis here, the spine going up, and this right here is the hip joint. And you can see the healthy cartilage in the ball and socket joint. And let's look at a picture of one that's arthritic, and you can see that the cartilage here has worn out. And patients typically with hip arthritis will have pain in their groin with weight bearing, so with walking. Sometimes they can have pain going down the thigh into the knee. Sometimes I have patients presenting with just isolated knee pain, and it's actually coming from hip arthritis. So here's a x-ray of a normal looking hip, and you can see this ball and socket joint here. This clear space that I'm pointing to right here is healthy cartilage. And you can see that there is a nice clear space all the way around. And then the x-ray on the right is a patient with severe arthritis in the hip. And there's quite a few changes noted on this x-ray. You can see that the ball has sort of moved up in the socket. There's bone on bone right here. There's changes in the bone where you can see some of this area has become sclerotic or hard from the two bones rubbing together. This patient has also developed some cysts in the bone from the two bones rubbing together. So what happens when a patient comes into the office complaining of hip or knee pain? Obviously, we conduct a full physical examination, but before we do that, we have you fill out a bunch of paperwork. And in that paperwork, we ask you all about your family history, all the medications that you've taken, any history of any surgery in the past, any medical problems that could possibly cause you to have pain in your joints, and then we go on to perform a physical examination. So what during the physical examination, we're looking for a range of motion of the joint, the strength of the musculature around the joint, if there's any swelling or skin changes, reflexes, and if there's fluid or any inflammation in or around the joint. And then we proceed to obtain x-rays, which we do right in the office, and then we review the x-rays together. So I'm going to talk a little bit about what I look for on an x-ray. This is an x-ray of a knee, and you could see this patient here has bone-on-bone arthritis on the inner side of the knee. So when I look for changes on the x-ray, I'm looking for loss of cartilage, which you can see on this x-ray here. I'm looking for cysts or spurs that are formed in the bone because of the arthritis. And is there a deformity noted on the x-ray as well as on the patient during the physical examination? So these are some of the simple things to look for on an x-ray. So I'm sure everybody here has probably taken Aleve or Motrin or Advil at some point in their life for some minor aches and pains. And that's the first line treatment for a patient that comes in complaining of joint pain. We put them on some anti-inflammatory medications. A lot of them are available over the counter, and of course there are prescription anti-inflammatories available. We also have physical therapy as an adjunct to help strengthen the muscles around the joint to support the joint better. And then there's steroid injections that we use for patients with arthritis. There's also injections that help lubricate the knee joint, and it's called viscosupplementation. There's different companies that make those injections, Supart, Synvisc, Heilgen, and those are pretty much approved just for the knee. I've also used them in certain cases off-label for other joints, but primarily used for knee arthritis. Arthroscopy is a surgical procedure, and that's reserved for patients that have a meniscal tear. I'm going to go back to one of the slides back here. If you remember, we talked about this slide earlier. This cartilage right here between the bones is called the meniscus. Sometimes we have patients that have a meniscal tear and also have arthritis in their knee. And a lot of times if their arthritis is not severe, then we can go in and perform what we call an arthroscopy, which is an outpatient surgical procedure. We make two little holes in the knee and we put a camera in there and a shaver, and we can shave out the torn cartilage. And that helps relieve a lot of the pain and prolong the inevitable future knee replacement. Well, it depends on the level of arthritis. If somebody has mild to moderate arthritis and they have a meniscal tear that's causing most of their pain, then once we trim out that torn meniscus, it can, you know, prolong their next potential surgery for years. So just like total knee replacement, we have total hip replacement as another procedure for arthritis of the hip. So arthroscopy was one of the adjuncts that we use to treat knee pain and meniscal tears. So for someone that has severe arthritis in their knee, that's bone on bone on one side of the knee, we can perform what we call a partial knee replacement. And this is a picture of somebody that has arthritis on both sides of their knee. You can see that the bone is wearing out on both sides. But if the arthritis is isolated to one side of the knee, we can perform a partial knee replacement. And this is a schematic of a partial knee replacement. Basically, we It's a surgery that's done in the hospital. It can be done as an outpatient, and usually it's just an overnight stay. And you can see the metallic surface that's been replaced on the top bone here and the bottom bone here, and then there's a plastic insert that goes in between the two. So this is a procedure that I performed, and you can see that the incisions are very small. The procedure itself takes about a half hour to 45 minutes, and the patient is up and walking the same day or the next day after surgery. The recovery time on a partial knee replacement is about 6 weeks. So initially we start them walking with a walker, and then they switch to a cane. With a partial knee replacement, there's not a lot of physical therapy involved as opposed to a total knee replacement. Let's talk about a full knee replacement or total knee replacement. And this is for patients that have a deformity in their knee, that have arthritis on both sides, on the medial and lateral sides of their knee. So once again, this is a schematic of a knee that has arthritis on both sides of the knee. And this is a schematic of a total knee replacement. You can see here that the top portion has been resurfaced with a metallic component, and the bottom portion has been resurfaced with a metallic component, and then there's a plastic insert that goes in between the two. And this is a video of of the normal range of motion of a patient. And then you can see this is how we do the procedure. We cut the end of the bone on both sides. And then there's a metal piece that goes on the top and the bottom, and the plastic insert between the two. And you can see the range of motion should be the same as, or as good as what you had before. This is an x-ray of a replaced knee. You could see the top metal piece, the bottom metal piece, and the clear space is represented by the new plastic insert, or the new cartilage, if you will. So this x-ray is looking at the knee from the front, and this is looking at it from the side. Your kneecap remains. I get this a lot. Did you take out my kneecap? No, I didn't. We just put a plastic button underneath it, but you still have your own kneecap. So this is your kneecap right there, and the clear space is a plastic button underneath the kneecap. So once again, we try to minimize the muscle cutting and splitting and skin incisions. This is a procedure that of a total knee replacement. You can see this incision's probably about 4 inches or so. So I mainly want to focus a little bit more today on this new technology that we've started using here at Waterman. And this is called the Stryker Shape Match Custom Fit Knee. So what this has enabled us to do is make knee replacement more precise than it currently is. And when a patient comes into the office with severe arthritis and they're a candidate for knee replacement, we send them for an MRI of their knee. And based on that MRI or a CAT scan, we can build custom cutting blocks which are perfectly fit for their knee. It's based on the anatomy of their knee. And so we send the MRI to the company, we get the custom cutting blocks back, and then we use those custom cutting blocks to perform the surgery. This is just going through the MRI scanning and the process of building the blocks. Anybody that needs a knee replacement is a candidate for the custom fit knee. Anybody that can get a CT scan or an MRI of their knee can have the custom fit knee. Why are we doing the custom fit knee? And I'm going to answer that question shortly. But here's some more videos on the process of building the custom cutting blocks. Currently, the way the traditional knee replacement works is the surgeon uses his expertise and his judgment to figure out where to place the knee. But what this has allowed us to do is make it very precise and anatomic, so the patient's anatomical alignment can be perfectly restored. And this is a video of the actual process of how we place the cutting blocks on the knee to perform the surgery. So this is the top bone that's being cut now, and we pin the cutting block on the bone, and then the slots allow us to make the cuts for the components that go on later. So that's the top bone, the femur bone, and then this is the tibial bone. So what these blocks allow me to do is to take off as less bone as possible and restore the anatomic alignment perfectly. I'm sure you've all heard of computer navigated knees. This is a step beyond that. And it makes the surgery much more efficient for the surgeon as well as much better for the patient. And then this is a video of the actual implants being cemented onto the knee. And that's the range of motion after the knee has been put in. So with a hip or a knee replacement, the recovery process is the most important. The surgery part is probably the shortest process of it all. The surgery takes about an hour, but the recovery is about 6 weeks to 3 months and sometimes longer. So the surgery itself takes an hour, you're in the hospital for about 3 to 5 days, and then you get discharged home or to rehab. Typical hospital stay can vary, rarely 2 days, usually averages 3 days. The patient's up and walking right away with a walker, and we try to get them up the same day usually of the surgery. Usually I tell people that they can return to their normal activities like sports, playing golf or tennis in about 3 months. So most people are doing real well in about 6 weeks, but they're not 100%. And if you have a sedentary job where you're pretty much sitting most of the time, you can return to work within 6 weeks. But if you have a job where you're standing or walking constantly, then I recommend waiting 3 months to return to work. But physical therapy is the most important thing you need to perform after or need to do after your surgery. The physical therapy starts, like I said, the same day after surgery, the same day or the next day after surgery. After a knee replacement, we have what we call a CPM machine, which is a continuous passive motion machine, which starts bending your knee right away. We put that on in the recovery room right after surgery, and we recommend patients use that for about 3 hours a day for the first 2 weeks or so. So every individual is different, and I get patients that come in and say, well, that guy got better in 2 weeks and I'm taking 3 months. And I always tell patients, don't compare yourself to the other. Everybody's body is different. Everybody's health status is different. So, but in general, most people are doing real well at about 3 months after surgery. I want to go back and talk about total hip replacement real quick. Just like knee arthritis, there's hip arthritis. And when you have a worn out hip, you have severe debilitating pain in the groin, you can't walk, and it's time to consider a hip replacement. Obviously, we try all the conservative measures before we jump to offering you a total hip replacement, anti-inflammatories, physical therapy. And hip replacement, once again, the surgery itself takes about an hour, 45 minutes to an hour, and you're in the hospital for about 3 to 5 days. So in a hip replacement, looking at this x-ray here, we have a metallic ball, a metallic socket, and there's a stem that goes down into the thigh bone. And this is an x-ray of a patient that had a replaced hip. After the hip replacement, we have certain limitations we place on the patient. If it's a right hip surgery, we don't recommend driving for about 6 weeks. If it's a left hip, it's about 4 weeks. So after a traditional hip replacement, we recommend patients have certain restrictions in order to help heal the muscles around their hip. And one of the possible complications that could occur after a hip replacement is a hip dislocation. There's a prosthesis that I've been using called the anatomic dual mobility hip, which is made by Stryker, and it has really enhanced the stability of the hip. And you can find more information on that on their website at Stryker.com. I think we're ready for questions, guys. Traditionally, with knee replacement surgery, you should not have one leg longer than the other, whether it's done the traditional way or the custom fit way. It's the hip replacements that could potentially do that. I see a lot of young patients in my practice. There's injuries from sports that occurred a few years ago that now have sort of caught up with them. And patients develop arthritis at a younger age. Obesity is a big factor. You see a lot of obese patients that have severe arthritis in their knee. So is a 45-year-old too young to have a knee replacement? I get that question a lot. What I tell patients is, how much is it affecting the quality of your life? Are you able to function? Obviously, we try everything conservative before we reach that point of saying you need a knee replacement. Knee replacements last about 20 to 25 years. And so we try to avoid doing them if we can in a younger patient, because what's going to happen is they're going to need a revision down the road. But if you're not able to function, if you can't walk because you have pain, if you can't exercise because you have pain, then I don't tell them that they can't have the surgery. Certainly, we do surgeries on young patients all the time. But keeping in mind that they may potentially need another revision surgery down the road. That's a possibility. And now, if you're having pain just associated with playing tennis, you may not necessarily need a knee replacement. You may have something simpler going on, like a meniscal tear or mild arthritis. I typically tell patients if they're having pain constantly with weight bearing, that's when they need to consider having a joint replacement. That's a good question. Most implants in this day and age are very similar with certain differences. And most of it is surgeon preference based. I use Stryker because I find that the instrumentation is very user friendly. I also like their technology. Their polyethylene, which is the plastic insert, has something called X3 technology. The most important thing is not so much the quality of the prosthesis, because they're pretty much the same, but it's the way the implant is positioned in the knee or the hip. If it's not positioned, even if it's off a few degrees, that can lead to early wear of that plastic insert. So that's what's most important. And that's why I like doing the custom fit knee, because it ensures that you get, even those few degrees of variability by doing the traditional way is avoided by doing it with the custom fit way. As you know, traditional knee replacement can be a fairly painful procedure. And so we've been using femoral nerve blocks to help alleviate a lot of the pain patients have postoperatively. So the anesthesiologist places a nerve catheter in front of the groin area, which helps numb the nerve after the surgery, or even before the surgery, but it lasts even after the surgery. And we keep it flowing for the first 2 days after surgery. Of course, we also use a pain pump, a morphine pain pump that the patient uses to give himself medication. And then we also have oral pain medication. There's been a huge difference in the way patients perform after surgery between having a nerve block and not having a nerve block. Obviously, sometimes the nerve block doesn't work, but most of the times when it takes on well, patients have a huge difference in their pain rating. Can you have knee replacements, both knee replacements done at the same time? And the answer is yes, you can. Do I recommend it? Probably not a good idea. Having one knee replaced is painful enough, and to try to recover from two at the same time is very difficult. Now, I have done them a few weeks apart, which makes it easier than having both done at the same time. Continuous passive motion, CPM machine. Why do some surgeons use it, and why don't some surgeons use it? So It's a very personal decision. Some surgeons like it and some don't. I found that there's a lot of variability in the patient's pain. Some people don't have much pain after surgery and others have a lot of pain after surgery. And I find it's better to be consistent with having a CPM machine and just encouraging the patient to see their knee moving after surgery, as opposed to a physical therapist coming in and trying to bend their knee and you know, patients hollering in pain. Now, there are certain institutions where they don't use CPM machines, and it's an institutional decision based on the surgeons and the physical therapists. A lot of it is also based on the physical therapists and the protocols that they have in place in terms of how the therapy is performed. So, but I still prefer to use it just because it's consistent. All my patients get it. Whether their pain rating is up or down, everybody gets it. You mean physical therapy? Usually I send patients to therapy for about 6 to 8 weeks after a total knee and about 6 weeks after a total hip. Now, initially we have them start therapy at home for the first 2 weeks, and then we switch them to outpatient therapy at the office. The first 2 weeks, they have a therapist that comes to the house, and they have a nurse that goes to the house as well to do the incisional care. The question is, can I return to my activities like jogging and tennis after my knee replacement? And the answer is yes, you can. And I usually tell people about 3 months after surgery. I don't recommend that you run any marathons. You know, obviously the more impact you have on your joint, the sooner it's going to wear out. But you can certainly return to low impact type activities, light jogging, biking, tennis, golf, all those are acceptable. You can certainly cross your legs after hip or knee surgery. Now, with a traditional hip replacement, they recommend you don't cross your legs because you can dislocate your hip. But with this new technology that I had mentioned earlier with the ADM hip, I don't restrict my patients from crossing their leg after 6 weeks from surgery, which, because of the prosthesis and the way it rotates, it gives you better range of motion and it prevents that dislocation. That's a great question. Obviously, smoking and or obesity are risk factors for potential complications after surgery. Will you be a surgical candidate? Sure, but you have to keep in mind that there may be risks involved with having those comorbidities. For example, if obesity is the problem, you know, there's a higher risk of infection, higher risk of blood clots. Sure. We don't know why it happens, but there has been a high association of avascular necrosis with scuba divers. So if, and I don't know if it has to do with the decompression issue, but there we see a lot of patients with hip avascular necrosis in scuba divers. But alcoholism is the number one cause. That's a good question as well. No, you do not have to use the same brand. It doesn't matter. You can use you can choose any surgeon you wish or any brand knee that you wish to have on the other side. The question was, hip dislocation is a common complication after surgery. What about the knees? Is that possible with the knee? It is possible. I've never seen it in all my practice, but it can happen. But it would take a significant amount of force, like a car accident or a fall from a significant height, for that to happen. If you had a knee replacement 10 years ago and it's bothering you, can you have it replaced again? Yes, you can. That would be a revision knee replacement. But there are other reasons why you may be having pain in your currently replaced knee, not necessarily that it has to be revised. There could be other issues like tendonitis or bursitis, or it could be arthritis in your hip that's causing pain referred to your knee. So you'd obviously have to get all those things checked out before you say you need a new revision. Sure. The oldest patient I did a hip replacement on was in their early 90s. So it can be done as long as the patient is healthy and is able to tolerate the surgery. Obviously, we get you medically cleared for surgery from your primary care doctor. And if they feel that you can withstand the stress of the surgery in terms of the anesthesia, then we can certainly perform the surgery. I'm sure you've heard of some of the recalls that have been going on. And that certainly can happen. Over time, you know, they find that there's an increase in metal ions in the body with this new metal on metal hip, and that led to a recall by one of the orthopedic companies. So certainly those things can happen. Obviously, all those patients that had the hip recall didn't need to have any further surgery. So a few did. So the other question was, is there a possibility of an infection? Anytime you have surgery, there is a possibility that you could have an infection. So that's one of the risks of having surgery, period. The prosthesis doesn't cause the infection, but the infection could be because of other causes. If somebody has a suppressed immune system or other medical issues that cause them to get an infection. Yes. If I'm bow-legged or knock-kneed, can I have knee replacement surgery to correct that? That's one of the main reasons we do perform knee replacement surgery. Obviously, the bow-legged or the knock-kneed resulted from arthritis in the knee most of the times. Unusually, it's a congenital issue where somebody was born that way, but most of the times it's because you have debilitating arthritis which caused the deformity. And so, yes, the answer is we can correct that with knee replacement surgery. Sure. The conservative options pretty much range from taking medication like anti-inflammatories and physical therapy, and the last would be a cortisone shot and or the joint fluid therapy that we had briefly mentioned, which is the gel injection. Those are pretty much the range of conservative options. And then after that, it's all surgical. Is there any role for stem cell treatment with knee arthritis? There has been some research that's been done on it. It's not a mainstream procedure, and it's still a lot of ifs and whats. So, okay. If I choose to have joint fluid therapy, how often do I need to get that? So it's a series of 3 to 5 injections, and it's a week apart. So you come into the office, you get the shot, come back the following week for 3 to 5 weeks, depending on the brand of the medication. You can repeat it every 6 months. So if it helps you and the pain starts to come back, it can be repeated every 6 months. Now I have patients that have had it for 2 years and are still going strong. So everybody's different. That's an interesting question. There is a genetic predisposition. So you see it in certain families. But as a general rule, not necessarily everybody's, you know, there are patients that I have that are in their 90s and their knees look like they were 15 years old. So not everybody needs a knee replacement. It's only if you develop arthritis and can't function. I think we're definitely seeing an increase in the number of joint replacements that we're doing, but I think there's a lot of factors. I think people are living longer, they're healthier, they want to be more active, and so that has led to more joints being replaced. I mean, I would say the average age of the patients that we do are in their 70s and 80s, you know? So people are just living a lot longer and they want to continue being active. It depends on your functional status. The question was, if I have MS, can I have a knee replacement? And the answer is, yes, you can. It depends on your functional status. I just did a patient recently that has MS and needed a knee replacement. But it really depends on how progressed the disease is. If you're still functional and you need a knee replacement to continue functioning at that level, then yes, you could have a knee replacement. The question is, I had a tibial plateau fracture, and that was 3 years ago, and now I feel some...
Actually, I've always felt every step I take.
So there is some pain involved with every step you take, but it's not limiting you from significant activities. And the answer is that you probably are developing arthritis in your knee because of that tibial plateau fracture, referring to post-traumatic arthritis. And chances are that you will probably end up needing surgery in the future. But obviously, I would try all the other modalities available to you. And because it sounds like you're still functioning at quite a high level. So, sure. What type of medications do I need to stop before I go in for my total knee or hip replacement? Anytime you have surgery, we recommend patients stop anti-inflammatory medications because they can thin your blood. There's a lot of over-the-counter supplements that patients take. For example, vitamin E is a blood thinner. There's a ginkgo, which a lot of patients take in their vitamins, that can cause thinning of their blood. And also, of course, if they're on blood thinners like aspirin or Coumadin or Plavix and some of the other newer ones out there, those, all of those need to be stopped a week before the surgery. The partial knee replacement is obviously for somebody that has isolated arthritis on one side of their knee. Is it possible that they need future surgery? Sure it is. If the other side starts to wear out down the road, a few years down the road, it may need to be converted to a total knee replacement. There are times when patients get a partial knee replacement and it doesn't work as well for them. And so in those situations, I've had to convert to a total knee replacement. Unfortunately, there's been a big rise in the number of partial knee replacements being done because it's convenient for the patient or convenient for the surgeon. And I think that it should be very, very important for the patient to understand the risks involved with having a partial knee replacement. I'm very picky with the ones that I do a partial replacement on, just for that reason, because I don't want to do a second surgery 2 years later. So, the conversion is not really difficult because the partial knee doesn't take off a lot of bone. Obviously, there's going to be more bone loss involved with doing a revision surgery, but it's still not as difficult as doing a total knee revision to another total knee revision. Okay. Daily exercise is highly recommended. Now, obviously, if you have significant arthritis and you have pain and you can't exercise, then exercising is not going to benefit you. But if you have mild to moderate arthritis and you're able to exercise and you can limit the amount of pain that you're having with other modalities, then I would recommend strengthening the knee, the muscles, to support the knee joint better. What I found most of the times is that patients can't function. You know, they can't exercise because they have such bad arthritis that they have to have their knee replacement first before they go back to doing their exercises. Are there any activities that I can't do after my hip or knee replacement? What I tell people is after your hip or knee replacement, low impact activities are okay. So if you are an avid skydiver, you can't go back to doing that. Okay? Sure. The question is, what is the total cost of a hip or knee replacement? Well, I'm going to estimate this just from what I've seen. What I've seen is about $35,000. That includes the surgery, your hospital bill, the anesthesia bill, the physical therapy postoperatively. That's just a ballpark. And does Medicare and or other insurances cover this? Yes, they do cover it. Obviously, Medicare covers 80%, and then if you have a supplemental insurance, that would cover the 20%. What is the cost of a prosthesis for a hip or a knee? It's generally around $5,000. It could be a little less or more, varying on the prosthesis and the company, and the contract the hospital has with the company. I don't think you need to baby the hip or the knee. You can use it normally. There's no restrictions on the way you sleep or the way you use it, except for, you know, you can't do the high impact type activity. Right. Sure. Thank you.